Hello everyone, this is Rahul Pandey, Assistant Professor from Chitkara University, Punjab, in the Curing Department. So with the help of this short video tutorial, I would like to cover the concept of Fermi level, carrier distribution and the quasi Fermi level. So these are the outlines of this presentation. So first of all, I will cover the Fermi function and then the density of a state, followed by the carrier density, and then the carrier density as a function of intrinsic parameters like intrinsic carrier concentration and then temperature. After that, I will cover the quasi Fermi level concept. So the outcome of this presentation is that the viewers will be able to understand the concept of Fermi Dirac distribution function, and they will be able to understand and will be able to evaluate the position of Fermi level if the concentration of carriers are given, and will be able to understand the concept of quasi Fermi level. So the very first topic of the presentation is that the Fermi function. So this is the formula by which a Fermi function is described. So electrons follows the Fermi Dirac distribution function, and its qualitative plot look like this. So in order to understand this plot, we'll solve this function for three different cases. So two cases are associated at T equal to 0 Kelvin, and one case is with when temperature is greater than 0 Kelvin. So at T equal to 0 Kelvin with E less than EF, so the numerator term of this exponent function turns out to be negative, and the temperature is already 0. So this will become negative infinity, and hence the probability function will be 1. So that means all the energy below the Fermi energy, we are taking this as a reference for Fermi energy. So for all the energy below the Fermi energy will be filled with the electrons. And for the second case, when E is greater than EF, the numerator term will be positive, and this term will become positive infinity. That will make this distribution function equal to 0. So that means all the energy below this EF will be filled with electrons, whereas all the energy states above this Fermi level will be empty. So let's take the third case at T greater than 0 Kelvin. So whenever we give temperature to the system, so electrons that are occupied the states which is just near to this Fermi level will leave their state, and the probability function will appear for energy greater than EF. So that is why as we increase the energy of the system, the Fermi function starts depleting near the Fermi level. So as the temperature is higher, this function depletes more, and all the probability will appear at the higher side of the Fermi function. But when E equal to EF, so we can test this value over here. So when E equal to EF, this function will become 0, this function will become 0 and will get 1 divided by 2. So that means irrespective of the temperature, we'll get the 50% probability at this particular point when energy is equal to EF. So this is how we understand the Fermi distribution function for electrons. Next, the density of state. So this is the typical plot of density of a state in semiconductors. Here is conduction, bottom of the conduction band, here is the top of valence band, and this energy level shows the intrinsic Fermi level. So this shows that the density of the states at E equal to EC is 0 in semiconductors, and it starts increasing as we increase the energy and moving in the deep inside the conduction band. Whereas the density of a state for the valence band is 0 at E equal to EV, and it starts increasing as we go below the top of the valence band. So this is the typical distribution of density of a state. So these states are available for the electron to be occupied, and these states are available for the holes to be occupied. So now with the help of the information that is given with the help of density of a state and the Fermi Dirac distribution function, now we'll understand and we'll evaluate the carrier concentration inside the conduction band and the hole concentration. sorry, the electron concentration inside the conduction band and the hole concentration inside the valence band. So electron concentration is given by the product of density of a state and the Fermi Dirac distribution function. And the hole concentration is given by the density of the state for valence band and 1 minus Fe. So in order to evaluate the electron concentration, we will integrate all the possible energy from the bottom of the conduction band to the top of the conduction band to get the electron concentration, and we'll do the similar thing for the hole to get the hole concentration. This thing will be clear once we discuss this using qualitative plots. So this is what I'm discussing. So carrier concentration, this is the band diagram of intrinsic semiconductor. This is for n-type semiconductor and this is for p-type semiconductor. This shows the density of a state, as we discussed earlier. This shows the density of a state. So density of state for all three cases are same, but the Fermi Dirac distribution function, so as we already discussed that for energy E equal to EF, the probability will be half, but for n-type and p-type semiconductor, the Fermi function moves upward and Fermi function move downward. So if we multiply this Fermi function with this density of state, we'll get the electron concentration. And if we multiply this 1 minus Fe with this density of state for holes, then we'll get the hole concentration. So for intrinsic semiconductor, the number of electrons are equal to the number of holes. But as we look for the n-type semiconductor, as the Fermi level moves closer to the conduction band, the number of electrons will be large compared to the number of holes, because 1 minus Fe function decreases, whereas Fe function increases. The similar thing appears for the holes also. As we increase the accepted doping density, the Fermi level moves closer to the valence band, and the product of density of valence band, density of a state and the Fermi function gives a higher hole concentration compared to electron concentration. Now semiconductor under thermal equilibrium follows the mass action law, which means electron concentration, the product of electron concentration and the hole concentration, is equal to the square of intrinsic carrier concentration. And the carrier densities can be expressed as a function of intrinsic carrier concentration and intrinsic Fermi level. So we'll not discuss the derivation of these formulas, but if it is required, I will make a separate video for the same. But now we are in a situation to conclude that under thermal equilibrium, we will have only one Fermi level that describes the distribution of electron as well as the hole. So let's verify the same using a numerical problem. So we have to obtain the relative position of EF with respect to EI for an n-type semiconductor, for an n-type silicon basically, with a donor density of 1 into 10 to the power 15 centimeter cube. And we can take Ni equal to 1.5 into 10 to the power 10 centimeter cube to solve this problem. So with the help of these formulas, we'll try to compute the relative position of Fermi level. So initially we are assuming that we are having two Fermi level, but later on we will find out that there is only one Fermi level that describes the distribution for both electrons and holes. So with the help of law of mass action, we can compute the hole concentration, that is 2.25 into 10 to the power 5 centimeter cube. And now we substitute the hole concentration here and electron concentration here. And surprisingly, we find out that both the Fermi levels are at the same position. So that means electron Fermi level, hole Fermi level are equal to the Fermi level in the at the thermal equilibrium. But the situation that we discussed recently will change if we trigger our semiconductor with some external mechanism, like a new Fermi concept will arise when we have large number of electrons as well as large number of holes. And in this particular situation, the law, the mass action law fails, and electrons, the product of electrons and the hole will not be equal to the square of intrinsic area concentration. And this situation will usually occur if we apply external bias or illumination. So before discussing the illumination, let's discuss the absorption inside a semiconductor. So whenever we are having a photon with the energy greater than the band gap of the semiconductor, that photon will excite the electron in the valence band, and that electron will make a jump to the conduction band and will create a hole. So a single photon can create an electron hole pair inside a semiconductor, provided its energy should be greater than the band gap, greater than or equal to the band gap of the semiconductor. Now we'll discuss, or we'll try to understand the absorption process in much more detail. So consider that we are having input photon flux, phi times input photon flux, and then we are having a material whose absorption coefficient is alpha and some thickness d. So as the photons travels inside the material, the number of photons keep on reducing, because each and every atom inside the material absorbs the photon, and the number of photon decreases exponentially. In other words, the intensity of the beam decreases exponentially. So transmitted photon flux that came out with this medium will be output photon flux will be equal to the input photon flux times exponent times minus alpha d. So let's assume a situation if we have very high absorption coefficient, so nothing will come out from this medium. So 100% absorption will be there. And if the thickness of this material is very large, then also the transmitted photon will be very, very low. But now with the help of this information, we'll try to compute the number of absorbed photon flux. So absorbed photon flux is nothing but the input photon flux minus output photon flux. So with the help of this equation, we can compute that the absorbed photon flux will come out to be this. But this equation is obtained without including the reflectivity from the surface. But once we include the reflectivity of the surface, this formula will come out to be this. So if reflectivity is 100%, so nothing will be absorbed. So if the reflectivity is very low, then only the photons will be absorbed inside the medium. So in order to absorb high number of photons, reflectivity should be low, absorption coefficient should be high, and the thickness should be high. And these are the typical representation of absorption, wavelength dependent absorption coefficient for different materials. Now, what are the consequences of illumination? So under normal circumstances, as we solve a numerical problem previously, so majority carriers comes out to be equivalent to the doping density, that is 1 into 10 to the power 15 centimeter cube. We are taking n-type silicon wafer, and the minority carriers are 2.25 into 10 to the power 5. And in this particular situation, mass action law holds perfectly good. But once we illuminate the semiconductor, and we are assuming that 10 to the power 12 new electron hole pairs are created, so what will happen to these majority and the minority carriers? It's very interesting to see. Majority carriers, initially majority carriers are 1 into 10 to the power 15, and after illumination 10 to the power 12 per centimeter cube carriers are added. But in compared to this term, this is very small, so we can neglect this. And the same thing happens with the minority carriers also. Previously the concentration was 2.25 into 10 to the power 5, but once we illuminated the wafer, we'll get 10 to the power 12 centimeter cube additional hole, and now this term is very small compared to 10 to the power 12. So a final concentration that comes out to be for majority carriers, it remains the same, but for minority carriers it comes out to be 10 to the power 12 centimeter cube. Now significant improvement in the concentration of minority carrier. For this particular situation, mass action law will not hold good. So this semiconductor or this wafer is now in quasi equilibrium state. So in order to understand the consequences of illumination, let's take a realistic problem. We are given three different semiconductor wafers with a thickness of 50 micrometer, 100 micrometer and 250 micrometer. All the wafers are doped with donor density of 1 into 10 to the power 15 centimeter cube, and all the wafers are illuminated simultaneously. Since the thickness of this wafer is very small, so only 1 into 10 to the power 7 centimeter cube electron hole pairs are created, whereas for 10 micrometer thick wafer, 1 into 10 to the power 10 centimeter cube electron hole pairs are created, whereas for 250 micrometer thick wafer, 10 to the power 12 centimeter cube electron per centimeter cube electron hole pairs are created. So for these three wafers, we have to find out the difference between the intrinsic Fermi level and the quasi Fermi level under the dark condition as well as under the illumination condition. So under dark condition, this answer comes out to be the same as we solved previously, because the difference between the Fermi level will not depend on the thickness, because we are not illuminating our semiconductor, we are not creating any extra electron hole pairs, and hence the answer will remain same for all the three cases. But now we'll see we'll obtain some interesting results once we illuminate the semiconductor. So for case one, when we are taking 50 micrometer thick silicon wafer, the number of electron hole pairs are generated 10 to the power 7. And if we solve the difference between electron quasi Fermi level and the intrinsic Fermi level, we find out that the answer will remain same, because majority carriers will remain same. There is no change in the majority carrier, as you can verify from this. Majority carrier concentration is very high, so there is no change in the number of majority carrier concentration. However, the minority carrier concentration changes significantly, 10 to the power 7. So, with the help of these two equations, we can compute the difference between the electron quasi Fermi level and the intrinsic Fermi level, as well as the whole quasi Fermi level and the intrinsic Fermi level. And surprisingly, we get two different Fermi levels that describes the concentration of electron as well as hole. So, this Fermi level describes the concentration of electrons, and this whole quasi Fermi level will describe the concentration of hole. So when we illuminated our semiconductor, we observed the splitting of Fermi level. So for the previous case, there was only one Fermi level, but here there were two Fermi levels. And now we'll take the case second for 10 micrometer thick silicon wafer. Now here 1 into 10 to the power 10 centimeter cube electron hole pairs are generated. Again, this number is very small compared to this donor density. So the position of electron quasi Fermi level will remain the same. Whereas if we substitute this value for the holes, then the position of the quasi Fermi level for the hole will change to 0.010 relative to EI. So it moves very close to EI. So for the previous case, it was much above the EI, but for this particular case, as the number of holes increases, this moves closer to EI. Now for the next case, for 250 micrometer thick silicon wafer, now we are having 1 into 10 to the power 12 centimeter cube electron hole pairs. And again, in comparison with this donor density, we can neglect this term. However, once we substitute this term for the hole, we are getting a relative difference between whole quasi Fermi level and the intrinsic Fermi level, that is minus 0.109. So with the help of this information, we can conclude now Fermi level, the whole Fermi level moves below the intrinsic Fermi level. So it started from this point under dark, and then it went to this point. After that, it moves to this point, and now it finally went to this point. Now, with the help of previous two cases and this case, we can conclude that increasing the thickness of the wafer increases the minority carrier concentration very significantly, whereas the majority carrier concentration will remain the same as we increase the thickness, and this is verified by the moment of this whole quasi Fermi level, which moves closer to the valence band. So thanks for watching. Please like, share and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you.